Hello, my name is Gaydon Wren. I am here to welcome you to the virtual Sachem Public Library and to introduce Thomas Z. Shepard, our speaker today. I live in New York City. I have my entire life. I've attended Broadway shows since before I was a teenager. And if you're also a resident of the New York area, probably your sense of Broadway is the same as mine. The show is the show, and the original cast album is a souvenir that maybe you take home if you particularly enjoyed the show. That is not the experience of Broadway that most people in America or in the rest of the world do. If you live outside of, say, a 100-mile radius of New York, the only chance you have to experience Broadway shows is through local productions, community theater, high school, college, that sort of thing, or perhaps a touring production. But you'll never get the chance to see the original stars of Broadway shows in the roles that they are known for and singing their most famous songs, except in three ways. Number one is on the Tony Awards, where each year the five nominated musicals send the singers for one song to perform it on the show. Number two would be the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, during which, for some reason, the Broadway actors come out of their theaters and stand outdoors in November and perform excerpts from their shows. Or you can buy the original cast album. And this is the way most people experience Broadway shows. If you pay attention to the liner notes, which give you the story, the characters, and how the songs fit into it, and if you have a good imagination, you can close your eyes, listen to the recording, and actually see the show as if it was happening right in front of you. But that only works if the producer of that recording has done a good job. And our guest today, Thomas Z. Shepard, has done that particular job as well as anybody ever. He worked for 14 years, from 1960 to 1974, at Columbia Records, ending as head of Columbia Masterworks. He then moved on to head RCA Red Seal from 1974 to 1983, and then to head MCA Records' Broadway and classical recordings from 1983 to 1986. Since then, he has been a prolific independent producer of Broadway shows. He's been responsible for the cast albums for Chicago, Crazy for You, 42nd Street, La Cage aux Folles, Me and My Girl, The Secret Garden, 1776, and Zorba. He's particularly associated with the works of Stephen Sondheim, for whom he produced Company, Merrily We Roll Along, Pacific Overtures, Sunday in the Park with George, and Sweeney Todd, among many other shows that he and Sondheim did together. He has won 12 Grammy Awards and is generally considered the greatest living producer of Broadway original cast albums. Today he's going to talk to us about one of his more interesting projects, the album Follies in Concert, which again teamed him with Stephen Sondheim. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Z. Shepard.
I've worked with Steve Sondheim for 15 years, between 1970 and 1985. So it encompassed the original cast album of Company, and it finished with the production I created with the New York Philharmonic, which we called Follies in Concert. At virtually the same time that Sondheim was writing Company, he was also working on a show with James Goldman, same guy he worked with previously on The Evening Primrose. He was working on a show which was originally called The Girls Upstairs. Later, the title was changed to Follies. And it was a very problematic show because it was a very difficult script which went through many, many different incarnations, including an earlier version where actually a murder took place. But the basic storyline is that a man, in this case named Weissman, who was really Florence Ziegfeld, fictionalized, has called back his Follies cast from 30 years earlier back to the theater that they performed in, because the theater is going to be torn down. So it's a celebration, a reunion, and a nostalgic get together of these people who haven't seen each other in all that time. That means that all the relationships, the loves, the hates that were not settled 30 years ago are now coming out again. It's a very complicated story. The characters, by and large, are not sympathetic. And frankly, it did not attract a paying audience. The show was not considered a success. However, the songs, most of which are homage to other composers, not an imitation, really, but sort of like a thank you to Jerome Kern, to the Silva, Brown and Henderson, to George and Ira Gershwin, there's at least one more very important one there, and I'm just going to have to wait till it comes in. Sigmund Romberg. The songs are fabulous. We wanted this show at Columbia. It would have been the recording to follow Company, and we couldn't get it. It's a small world. Goddard Lieberson had recently been appointed the head of a new division at CBS called Cinema Center Films. The first film that Cinema Center Films ever produced and released was one called Something for Everyone. And the two leads in the show were Angela Lansbury and Michael York. Now, the other curious thing about this is that the show was directed by Hal Prince, who directed Follies and who directed Company, okay? Hal was very happy with Company, but he wasn't very happy with Something for Everyone because the film was not a success. And he attributed a significant reason for its lack of success to what he believed was insufficient advertising. In other words, you know, he blamed the movie company for not marketing the film well. Now, the movie company was run by Goddard Lieberson, who was also president of Columbia Records. So Hal was annoyed. He was more than annoyed. He was, unlike Hal, he was in this particular instance somewhat vindictive. And even though we wanted the recording of Follies, he wouldn't give it to us, or sell it to us, or lend it to us. And when instead he made a deal with Capitol Records, and I believe the producer of the recording was a guy with a good reputation, Dick Jones. What Hal and Steve didn't bank on after the contract was signed is that it would be up to Capitol whether to record the whole show or not. And Capitol decided that they could not sell two LPs, two vinyls of this show. For one thing, the show didn't look like a great big hit. And secondly, it would be more expensive to record and more expensive to produce and more expensive for the purchaser to get the album. So for totally economic commercial reasons, Capitol would not record the whole show. And it fell back to Sondheim and Goldman and Prince to decide which numbers to leave out altogether or which numbers to truncate so that at least in some form they would exist. Well, you can imagine what a demoralizing effect this had on Steve and Hal and Jim, and not to mention the entire cast. They went to Manhattan Center to record it. Manhattan Center has a wonderful ballroom on the 8th floor, which is great for the New York Philharmonic. I would not, by my own choice, choose to use it to record a Broadway show, but that's only part of the problem. Not only was it not very well recorded, but the cast was somewhat demoralized because they couldn't really do their thing. And the recording, by and large, was an elegant mess and was a great disappointment to those of us who adored the score. This was, to us, one of the greatest musical comedy scores we ever heard. And it was being insensitively released. Okay, now we're gonna cut a whole lot of years. We're gonna go from 1971 to 1983. And in 1983, I was vice president of RCA Red Seal, and my two areas of expertise were Broadway and classical. Red Seal became the label for classic for Broadway recordings, which it hadn't been before I got there. Much to, I guess I never said this before, but I think what's rather important is that when I went from Columbia Records, where I recorded Company, to RCA, where I recorded all the following shows by Sondheim, what I forgot to mention was he came along with us. And that's really nice. And it's not just because of me. The president of RCA was a newly named president named Ken Glancy, who was a fabulous guy and had great instinct and appreciation for music. So all those years that followed Company, which was with Columbia, everything else I did with Steve was with RCA. And the final thing I did with him is what I'm going to tell you about now. Because in 1983, Ted Chapin came into my office. Ted was running the Rodgers and Hammerstein office. When he was in college, he actually attached himself to the show Follies wherever it was playing and wound up writing a whole book about it. I think there's nobody who knows more about Follies than Ted Chapin. Curiously enough, Ted Chapin's father, Schuyler Chapin, was my first boss at Columbia. Now, Ted came to see me and said, "You've done a lot of studio cast recordings. Those are recordings where you assemble the cast, perhaps hire an orchestrator, hire a conductor, and you make a recording which hasn't been on the day. You create." And there are a lot of these go around, and some of them are very beautiful. And it was very tempting to think that I could take a show like Follies and make a studio cast, but there was something wrong with that idea because Follies is complicated. The relationships between people are complicated. That those relationships, those pluses and minuses of intimacy, and apathy or even downright dislike are hard to do working with a cast that has never done the show together. Now, I wasn't going to try and assemble the original cast. I mean, a lot of them were still alive, but this was a chance to do something fresh, and this was a chance to do the whole show. So what I came up with, in which Ted agreed, I said, why don't we try and get it done as a live event, as a concert, which, you know, a semi-stage concert, which could be fully rehearsed. And I said, look, you know, I've had a good relationship with the New York Philharmonic because I've done recordings through the years there with Boulez, with Bernstein. And I had done, as a matter of fact, a kind of all-star Beethoven Ninth with them. That's almost neither here nor there, but the point of it is my relationship with Nick Wedger, who ran the orchestra, was a good one, and went back a long way. So Ted and I went to Nick Webster, said, how would you like to have the Philharmonic do a concert of the Sondheim show Follies, the complete score. Now, by the way, that's not an easy request, because what you're really asking, you're asking the person who runs the orchestra to be willing to subjugate that orchestra to be only an accompanist, basically, you know, because all these actors are in front of them. Now, as far as I can tell, this is the first time, by the way, Nick Webster said yes almost immediately, which is a miracle. But he was a great guy, is a great guy. We had a chance, of course, to do this our own way, with our own people. And what happened was, as soon as Ted and I went back to see Sondheim and said, hey, we got the New York Philharmonic, how do you feel about that? He said, great. Okay, so we were off and running. Casting it was very easy in one respect. Once it was announced that this project was going to exist, everybody wanted to be in it. I can hardly tick off the number of really famous, established artists who phoned me, you know, begging to be in it, which unfortunately, you know, we couldn't double cast it. Something I should mention, I mean, obviously this isn't the first time that an orchestra has done musical comedy, but I still believe it's the first time that an orchestra, a symphony orchestra, was used for an entire show. This was not the Boston Pops with guest artists. This was a complete show. Okay, we was enthusiastic. RCA was enthusiastic because what we thought we could do, if we could construct the concert so that it would be right for a recording with the right amount of continuity, et cetera, you know, we would have virtually a ready-made recording. And that's the way the concert was planned. It was planned as a staged recording session. I had the enthusiasm of RCA. The agreement in principle was that RCA paid for the recording, but the Philharmonic underwrote its live concert. And Ellen Krass, who ran the video company, the name of which escapes me at the moment, they agreed to pick up all the costs for the video. Now, the video was not going to be of the entire show, but it was going to be of selected highlights plus I guess they call it now B-reel material, you know, background stuff, rehearsals, little incidental things. Steve felt strongly that we needed the right director, and he asked Herb Ross. Herb Ross had done the directing of the film The Last of Sheila, which was a mystery that Steve wrote with Anthony Perkins. Herb produced, directed a great many musicals, and I believe that in the days when there were like musical comedy adult summer camps, one of them was called Tamament, that both Steve and Herb Ross were up there, Herb learning the fine art of putting on a whole show in a week. And that's a skill that very few people have. As a matter of fact, Herb did this, I think, probably in about 5 days. He did a brilliant job. The casting was fun. Steve particularly wanted Barbara Cook to play Sally, and George Hearn to play Benjamin Stone. We collaborated a lot on other castings, and we used Daisy Prince, Liz Calloway, Howard McGillin. But for principals, we had an absolutely stellar cast. We had Elaine Stritch to do Broadway Baby. We had Lillian Montevecchi, Adolph Green, Betty Comden, Phyllis Newman, Lee Remick, which was one of Steve's major choices. He wanted Lee Remick very much for this. Lee Calvanese, because there's a song in in Company called One More Kiss, which is sung not only by the young girl who first sang it in the Follies, but also by this older woman who was once this one girl. And Paul Gemignani and I went to visit Licia Albanese. She agreed to come out of retirement to do it. We rehearsed the piece with her. Sondheim was delighted. I needed somebody to play Roscoe, who sings the opening number of Beautiful Girls, which is a wonderful song. And I'll talk more about that in a moment, but I think I want to give you some more background first. This looked like it was going to be smooth sailing. Some of you may remember a man who was murdered by his two sons, Jose Menendez. He came to RCA Records from Hertz Cars. Hertz was owned by RCA. He was the meanest, cleverest, very smart, smoothest psychopath I think I've ever dealt with. Well, we didn't get along at all. That's pretty obvious. And that became even worse because there was a big story on me in a New York Times magazine, and it was not very flattering to him. All right. So Jose did what Jose could do. He pulled the plug on the project. He said, we're not going to go forward. Now, you have to know that this was not my first problem. My first problem was Steve said, you got to get Jim Goldman to do some revision of the script so this will play as a concert. You know? But he and were not talking to each other. There was a feud that happened because Jim's wife, Bobby, had interior decorated Steve's new house, and either Steve didn't like the work or didn't like the bill. Whatever it was, that absolutely soured his relationship with Goldman. So it was up to me to persuade Goldman. So I went to visit Goldman and his wife, beautiful penthouse apartment on Park Avenue. And they were very cordial, and we had a drink. I remember walking over some rubble because they were reconstructing being done, which seems appropriate for Follies, that there should be rubble. Anyway, we sat there and I pitched them on what I had in mind. I told them everything that I've now told all of you. And Bobby Goldman said, Mr. Shepard, we don't give a shit about Follies. So I knew I had nowhere to go but up. She went on to say a few more unpleasant things, but at least we parted relatively amicably. And a few days later, Jim called me and said, we're a go, we can do this. So, okay, so that hurdle was over, and I thought that was going to be the end of my hurdles because I forgot all about how much Jose Menendez hated my guts. So that was my second. So after having succeeded with Jim, I couldn't get anywhere. Even though Jose was not the president of the label, he was brought into RCA because RCA was not doing very well. He was supposed to be a very good bean counter and knew how and when to fire people and to minimize projects and maximize profits. So although he wasn't the president, he was given the rather unusual ability to be the last person to sign off on any contract. So even though the president of the company was going along with me on Follies, he was actually being vetoed by Menendez. Well, we had this fabulous concert planned. Steve was very, very upset. He said, you know, we're only doing this for the recording. But of course, that turned out not to be true. What turned out to be true was that the concert was a sensation. But I had that hurdle to get through. I had to try and find other people who would back a recording, and that's a very tricky situation when you work for one label. I mean, it's tantamount to treason. Well, I'll cut to the chase. I mentioned to you earlier that I had done a gala concert a few years prior to that of the Beethoven Ninth with Philharmonic. It happened that when I did that concert, among other people that I invited, one of them was Thornton Bradshaw, who was the chairman of the board at RCA. He loved that concert. When it came to his attention that Menendez had killed this project, somehow, through ways that were never disclosed to me, somehow, through Thornton Bradshaw and the president of RCA Records, Bob Sommer, the project was on. You have no idea what we went through in that. When RCA had canceled the project, the newspapers were having a field day. They were saying, this is the truth, by the way, all tickets for both concerts at the Philharmonic sold out in 4 hours, complete sellout, RCA pulls out of the project. So that's an ugly headline. So there was also pressure being brought to bear for RCA to get back into the game. So they got back into the game. Everything was on go. And then Herb Ross had a fantastic idea. He said, if we could separate the New York Philharmonic into two groups with a runway between them, we could introduce this first number, Beautiful Girls, with each of these actresses first coming down the runway, beautifully costumed, as you may well imagine, beautifully costumed. Now, I had to get the Philharmonic's permission for this. You can't force an orchestra to chop itself in half, but they understood what we were trying to do, and they agreed. And the way it worked out was I put all the strings, I'm now giving this to you from audience point of view, all the strings on the left side of the divide. And all of the woodwinds, brass, and percussion on the right side of the divide. And then these women could come down through the center one by one, beautifully costumed. Now, by the way, an added benefit of all this is it made the recording a lot easier, because with all the strings on one side and no trumpets or trombones blowing around them, it was much easier to make a good recording. I think we did make a good recording, by the way. And something happened that I never anticipated, but those of you who remember the Judy Garland album, Judy at Carnegie Hall, you may recall that during the overture, where they play all the famous songs that she had sung, the house kind of explodes because it's a reminiscence. And so by the time the show begins, the electricity is way, way up. Now, what happened here is that as Arthur Rubin, as Roscoe, sings Beautiful Girls, down this ramp, beautifully costumed, are Liz Callaway, Elaine Stritch, Lillian Mantovecchi, Betty Comden, Phyllis Newman, Lee Remick, Erie Mills, I hope I haven't left anyone out. And the audience went wild. They went absolutely crazy. And what I want you to hear now is this opening of Follies in Concert with the New York Philharmonic, because the audience, and by the way, one critic even said that I enhanced the applause. I did not. What you're hearing is exactly what happened at the concert. And so first you're going to hear the voice of Weissman, who is Ziegfeld, and he's being portrayed by Andre Gregory. And then you're going to hear Artie Rubin singing Beautiful Girls with a small combo, piano, bass, and drums, separated from the rest of the orchestra. And when he finishes the first verse, after this small combo, the whole Philharmonic comes in and the women start to parade down and the audience explodes. Here it is.
So many of you came. I am astounded. Welcome to our first and last reunion. I'm Dmitri Weissman. Every year, between the wars, 1919 to 1941, I staged a Follies in this theater. Since then, for 30 years, this house has been a home to ballet, rap, movies, blue movies, and now, in a final burst of glory, it's to be a parking lot. Before that happens, I felt an urge to see you one last time. A final chance to glamorize the old days, to stumble through a song or two, and lie about ourselves a little. So, to get things going, the inevitable Roscoe. Here, as always, to bring on the Weissman girls.
Hats off, here they come, those beautiful girls. That's what you've been waiting for. Nature never fashioned a flower so fair. No rose can compare. Nothing respectable, half so delectable. Cheer them in their glory, diamonds and pearls, dazzling jewels by the score. This is what beauty can be, beauty celestial, the best you'll agree. All for you, these beautiful girls.
This is how statues
I'm sure you all were able to imagine how terrific this was. You must know that I had to imagine it too, because I was in a sound truck about a block away. Thank you very much.